Thank you for coming to today's lecture of the International Studies Institute series. The overall topic is peace from conflict to reconciliation. And what a good way to be almost concluding our presentations with the director of the Peace and Justice Program here at UNF, Jamal Martin, who also holds an appointment with African Studies.
School of Medicine, Family Community Medicine.
Okay. And has done more things than maybe five active people together who are committed. And has been most generous in collaborating with us in a good way, to create more dialogue here at UNM and bring many different points of view. I'm Eleni Baste, I'm the director of the International Studies Institute, but this is really a team effort that has made it possible, including the support of many of my colleagues in the university and programs that have also helped with the expenses of the series. I would like to introduce Kate Kelsey, who is the dean of University College and the Honors College, who will be introducing Jamal Martin more formally and then asking the first couple of questions. And some of the people here are taking this class for credit. If you have any questions afterwards for your assignments, we can talk after class. Thanks.
So thank you, Eleni. You already introduced Jamal and said all the sort of official things I was going to say about him. Faculty member in multiple departments, multiple degrees. But I remember the first time I heard Jamal speak. And at that time, we were in a, he probably doesn't even remember, we were in some conference room somewhere over on the medical side of Lomas. And I just thought, I could listen to this guy forever. I mean, he's so, it's not just the way he speaks, but also what he says. And I certainly hope that that's how you feel after you hear Jamal speak to you about this particular perspective on international studies. So you don't want to hear me speak, you want to hear Jamal speak. So there you go, Jamal.
Thank you, Kate and Eleni, and thank you, students, for showing up and participating in this lecture series. Bear with me. I've got lots of information. I've got lots to say, and I'm a shy person, but once I start talking, that's it. You can forget it. So the title for this particular talk is Can Public Health Sciences Education Influence Global Conflict Transformation? And I don't know if you saw the flyer or not, but in the flyer, I quoted an excerpt from Martin Luther King's Nobel Peace Prize winning speech about the problems of the world today. And I also quoted one of his speeches where he talked about a world house and communities, the global community coming together in these issues of peace and reducing conflict. And the third quote that I had mentioned in the flyer was when he talked about health issues and the fact that of all the injustices that exist, perhaps the injustice in healthcare is the most tyrannical of all forms in many sense. So I want to kind of use that background to sort of talk about a pet project of mine, which has been involved in not only the primary prevention of psychopathology, but prevention. In fact, my dissertation dealt with prevention of violence and using cognitive behavioral sciences and working with children and how children's brains, children who've been exposed to violence and trauma, how they react and how we can reduce some of that trauma. So I want to sort of get into this notion of talking about some of this. And quite frankly, this is this talk is the third part of a trilogy that I've been working on this semester. The first part was a talk I gave at the Center for Conflict Studies out in Monterey, California a couple of weeks ago, where I talked about anti-oppressive education being used in peace studies, research, practice, and teaching. The second talk was a couple of weeks ago in the communications and journalism, where I talked about a field trip that I had taken to Palestine and Israel. And that particular talk was called The Built Environment, Population Health Inequities Under Settler Colonialism in Palestine, Israel. And this is the third piece of this trilogy. And I'm thinking that, okay, all this stuff rolled in my head. Now it's either book or paper. But the paper is probably the easiest thing to do right now because there's a journal that's looking for something like this in January. So I'm going to be busy during the next few weeks as I collaborate and coordinate all these things. But as you can see from this slide where I'm talking about global issues and international development, and as you can see from this word balloon, you know, you see many of the issues that we are faced when we talk about, you know, conflict and transformation. And one of the things that I want to quote down at the bottom is this notion of how do we have a global civil society? And Spring, who teaches at City University of New York in 2004, He talks a lot about globalism in education, and he identifies neoliberal education as being one of the big problems in the world today, neoliberal education ideology in particular. And he says that basically it's a result of neoliberal education and ideology that we see so much now going on in terms of environmentalism and education and human rights education. So I think it's worth mentioning that as we talk about the myriad of these issues and how we consolidate them. Now, these are wicked problems, as you can see from these balloons here. And many times people often refuse to get involved in global issues because they think they're too complicated or they're too complex. And I want to say that they're not that complex, and the way that we have to handle them is to be able to understand how do you integrate your thought and your thinking and basically challenge ourselves and our metacognitive abilities. By that I mean, how do we think about thinking while thinking to improve our thinking as we deal with these complex problems? What are the integrated thoughts that become part of that process? And I think that as we talk about transdisciplinary studies, and by transdisciplinary studies I mean going above, beyond, and across and in between the different disciplines and looking for those gaps of knowledge and how they help us form new opinions and new streams of consciousness and thought about solving complex problems. Unfortunately, in our universities, we tend to just look at it from a disciplinary perspective only, thinking that we can solve a complex problems by looking at ecology alone or economics alone or psychology alone, and I differ with that. Now, last few minutes, I thought about this, and I made some changes in these slides, and this is from a textbook that I used when I taught environmental psychology. And, you know, when we talk about global problems and we think about, you know, local, in fact, I would say that, you know, when we think about New Mexico is a microcosm for all the complex problems that we see in the world in terms of hunger, poverty, conflict, myriad of the different issues. But this particular graph, you know, really got my attention. And I thought, when you look at these data points, you see that, you know, you look at the space and time and see the present and 1 year. And as you look at these points and you go as you continue on through space, through family, community, state, nation, world, with that last data point there, you see that many people aren't concerned about the world situation. And that's really sort of freaked me out. And this is from an old textbook. And I thought, like, wow, you know, how do we increase people's values and knowledge and understanding about how we work locally, you know, while thinking globally in many ways? Many people are just concerned about themselves, their family, the community, the state, the nation, or the world. And I'd like to see that thought expanded based upon what, you know, Martin Luther King said in that final World House speech. So for those of you who want to do the research, this is a nice project, a nice idea to do some projects and collect some data points and figure out, are we still in the same place or have we narrowed that gap? Does that make sense? Okay. So, this Latin quote, Salus populi suprema lex esto. This is a quote from Cicero, the Italian orator, the Roman senator. It says a lot to me because this is something I firmly believe in, and that is the fact that when you translate this in English, it says, the health of the people or the health of the population is the supreme law of the land. Let me repeat that. The health of the population is the supreme law of the land. So when I think about that and I think about my work in public health and medicine and prevention, you know, I have to think about things that have an impact on people's health. When I worked with UNICEF and WHO many years ago, one of the things that I learned is that you cannot have a healthy economy or healthy society unless you have healthy people. So we have to invest in health, and health is just more than pills and medicines, as we'll soon see. So part of my, you know, that first trilogy talk that I told you that I gave, these are the different lenses that I look at this through: Black radical intellectual international tradition, supremacist ideology, oppression and injustice, structural violence as a human rights violation, the third revolution of public health as a social institution, and global learning, public health ethics, and strategic peace building, education, and practice. As mentioned, there's a lot there, but I wear four or five different hats, although I wear this one a lot, but I wear five or four different hats, and I have to integrate them, so this is an opportunity for me to show some synthesis and some expression of thought on that level. But I will answer this first question first, what I mean by Black radical intellectual international tradition. Historically, it's been said that, or it's been noted for a long time, that African Americans were not supposed to participate in global affairs or global issues or foreign issues. And I would say that's a myth, because, you know, from the days that the slaves first arrived on the shore, they were thinking about human rights, not civil rights and property. But during the 30s, 40s, and 50s, African Americans took their eyes off the prize and started thinking about civil rights, you know, at a local level rather than expanding the global talk about global issues. And there's a whole history of that in terms of how it manifested during the 30s and 40s, beginning with many different people, including Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, SNCC, and so forth and so on. So let me run through some of that for you very quickly. One of my favorite pictures of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X talking together. The center picture is about the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which is big during the 60s. And some of you may, I don't know if you know the picture on the far right. How many people recognize that photo? I know at least a couple of people do. Okay. This was a young student activist by the name of Mark Hampton. And the thing that ties all three of these people together is that they were all murdered and assassinated for talking about human rights. and talking about the global issues. Okay, and we have very few people doing that today. So when we talk about black power, which was a misnomer, many people misunderstood it, but what people were talking about was the power to define themselves, the issues of the power to control one's own condition and destiny, self-determination, and to vote for one's own community, and the power to use politics to enhance their own economic condition. That's what black power was. It wasn't a violent militant thing, as some people like to think. And it began with students and student activism in the 60s. So I've quoted from Martin Luther King here, racism. He said the three biggest problems of the world today are racism, and I had to slash racialization, the verb and not the noun, materialism, poverty, and militarism. And so I'm going to talk a little bit more about this whole issue of globalization, the built environment, and structural violence, and how this ties into the issues of conflict. So we begin with critiques. As we talk about this intellectual tradition of stepping outside of the boundaries and borders, critiques are the beginning of critical human consciousness. And I'm a big fan of meta-theoretical approaches. You know, if I find a theory approach that works and I think it is going to do me some good to help reduce oppression, then I'm for it and I'm into it. But as we talk about these meta-theoretical revolutions, we have to think about how do they help us dismantle or eradicate domination and discrimination? How does it help us foster human liberation, freedom for life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness? How does it transform society? And does it lead to democratic political action? So let me back up for just a little bit and talk about that second tier that I talked about a few weeks ago with the time that I spent in Israel and Palestine earlier this year. And this was some empirical research I did based on exchange of looking for a just peace in Israel and Palestine, which as we know is a very long conflict. And through this work, I went through refugee camps, neighborhoods, community centers, historic villages, university settings, interactions in the Negev with the Negev Bedouins in the desert, walking and driving tours, the maze of concrete tunnels, checkpoints, controlling movements. And I collected a lot of quantitative as well as qualitative data. And when I talked to the people, I talked to social workers, the people, UNM representatives, university people, and they just said, just tell our story when you get back. Just tell our story. So I tried to do a very good job of that last week. But I was doing this because I'm trying to find a critical pedagogy of place to understand structural violence, which has become a big part of my work now. My dissertation, as I mentioned before, dealt with individuals who have experienced violence. And since that time, I've expanded to structural violence. Okay, the Palestine-Israel Field School experience is validated by Lubin and others, opens up what Shura calls a new policy archaeology. How do we use archaeological tools to excavate policies and figure out where they've gone wrong, where they've gone right, and what needs to change? And I think that can be used to transform strategic peace building education. The six bullet points you see on the side there are the six issues that deal with settler neo-colonialism, racialization, exceptionalism, expansionism, denial, elimination, and securitization. And we'll come back to those in a moment or so. So this is just a matrix just showing, these issues of the built environment, the natural resources, human security issues, climate systems, societal stability, the environmental vulnerabilities, the human vulnerabilities, the climate sensitivities, conflict sensitivities. I'm a firm belief that we have to get to root causes of things. It doesn't make sense to try to extrapolate these and take them on one at a time. Although some people may like picking lowest hanging fruit from the tree, but that's always going to fall down to the ground first. We might as well take on the root problems as they begin. So anyway, and I hope this is going to generate into something that I'm working on in spring, where I'm helping to put on a conference on global health and human security. So I'll come back to that slide then also too as well at that time. So the question now begins, when we have these discussions with a lot of people, are we talking about anti-oppression education or multicultural education? And as you can see, there's conservative, liberal, and critical views, and it's not really the political side of that. But my teaching at many times, my teaching involves many of these different approaches. Sometimes I talk about the specific contributions approach, like I did a few moments ago when I talked about, some assassinated folks. I talk about teaching with cultural sensitivity and tolerance, but I also talk about culturally relevant instruction, culturally responsive teaching, appropriate pedagogy. And for the most part, over the last couple of years, most of my teaching falls into this area, teaching from a social political context, as well as teaching as a resistance to counter hegemonic practice. Okay? So that means using critical theories and how do we use education to liberate minds and hearts and souls. We had a discussion with somebody out on Smith Plaza a couple of days ago, and he asked me something about peace, and I said, well, how do you define peace? And he said he didn't really have a definition for it. I said, well, that's okay, because it's hard to define, but you know it by its absence, But he seemed to be against peace, so I said, so what's the alternative? If you're not for peace, what's the alternative? That's far worse, violence. So I have to be biased in my opinion, because I'm sick and tired of seeing violence. As I told people before I started teaching, I was in healthcare. I was an adrenaline junkie. you know, and rush into the yard to intubate people and serve people, put people in life support systems. And I think in the last 25 years of my life, I've seen enough death, dying, and suffering to last me a lifetime. So I'm really into prevention. So, you know, so let's take on and explain this racialization part very simply. You know, people, when we talk about social justice, a lot of people like to quote Rawls. And Rawls is interesting, and everybody's quoting John Rawls because he talks about social justice. But the only thing that's missing from Rawls' theory of social justice is that he doesn't talk about racialization and racism, okay? So Mills' Racial Contract in 1997, which is a fabulous read, and it's only 98 pages, and it's definitely worth reading. But he gives us an overview of the political, moral, epistemological issues, the historical actualities, the exploitation. He gives you details in terms of space, how it's enforced through violence and ideological conditioning, and the naturalized merits. So one of the things I want to say about this notion of racialization, that it comes from a place of supremacist ideology, you know, and this is supremacist ideology, basically, you know, these 4 points that I add here lately. It supports irrationality, it inhibits intellectual growth, and it negates democracy. So here's my little formula for structural institutionalized racism. Supremacist ideology plus discriminatory acts plus structural dominance equals oppression. You can go backwards and say the same thing. It still means the same thing. Algebraically, however you want to look at it, you know, we'll see this. So by oppression, how am I defining oppression? I'm talking about ageism, genderism, sexism, ableism, language discrimination issues. You know, all those things fall under oppression. So at some point, we have to say, like, why are we singling these different pieces out? Why don't we tackle the whole thing and wipe it out? And that's my perspective as a prevention person. Okay? So by oppression, problem with oppression is that it leads to 5 different types of injustices. Distributive injustice, procedural injustice, retributive injustice, moral exclusion, and cultural imperialism. The manifestations of this injustice, exclusion, omission, devaluing, discrediting, appropriating, trivializing, misrepresentation, using stereotypes, creating scapegoats, tokenism, prejudice, marginalization, discrimination, use of slurs, exploitation, systemic violence. You know, this is why you see over the country now, the last few days, weeks or so, students all over the place are speaking out, because they are recognizing these things and they're seeing how these forms of violence or these injustices result in microaggressions. You know, and if you're not sure what microaggressions are, it's like the old Chinese saying, death by 1,000 paper cuts. Okay, race is a myth, but racism slash racialization is real. There's internal racism, acceptance by members of stigmatized races about negative messages about their own abilities and intrinsic worth. There's personally mediated racism. There's institutionalized racism and cultural racism. What I'm really going to speak on today, really in many ways, is this institutionalized racism. I'm old enough to remember Jim Crow. I grew up during Jim Crow. I was told that I can't sit at a particular counter because I'm colored. In fact, my birth certificate still says that I'm colored. And I've never changed it because I think there's something historical in it and I need to preserve it in many ways. But when I grew up in the South, we knew various things that were going on. In 1963, my family moved to New York and I learned a different form of racism. You know, I moved away from the overt forms to the covert forms of people smiling in your face and stabbing you in your back. And while we've gotten better with some of that, you know, personally mediated racism, it still exists. But I want to focus on this institutionalized racism, the stuff that's embedded in traditions, education, books, knowledge, the way things are taught, you know, that perpetuates, that maintains the status quo of that supremacist ideology. So this is from the Aspen Institute, how structural racism produces racialized outcomes, the context, the current manifestations, and the outcomes. And when we look at those outcomes, you know, it sees that it leads to ongoing racial inequalities. So I'm going to move a little bit quicker because I know I've got just such little time here. So how does this link up to institutionalized racism and health status as we look at population inequities? Institutionalized racism can lead to direct effects or indirect effects. The direct effects can be latent, pathways, or cumulative, and the indirect effects can be material interpretations or the psychosocial interpretations. The thing that bothers me the most about this is that when we have a system that this institutionalized racism, these traditions are embedded in, you know, what happens to the children here? This stuff begins in childhood. And we've learned now from a lot of our disease studies that to do away with biological determinism, this whole notion, and I'll say some more about that, but we're finding out that the chronic diseases that begin, you know, that people experience later in life because of this lag time, they start out early in childhood and those early childhood experiences. In fact, when you single it out and look at how much care are we giving to women and children, how much education are they getting at very early ages, so they have protective factors. So that they can, you know, because education is the most robust predictor of health status. Education is not just about producing wealth, okay? So globalization, the built environment, structural violence. You know, I mentioned, you know, the Palestine-Israel thing, but you can walk out your door. You can walk through Albuquerque and do, you know, shoe leather epidemiology, and you can see what sides of towns are nice and which side of towns are not so nice. You look at Tanawan. You can go to South Valley. You can go here, you know, various districts. But you see that we're talking about structures that are created by humans for humans and used for human activity. It's the material, spatial, and cultural products of human labor. So it's land use patterns, distribution across space and housing activities, transportation systems, physical infrastructure of roads, services provided by the system, urban design and arrangement of appearances. You know, why is it certain communities that when you go through them, you don't see healthy food stores or library or clinic? You see fast food places. You see fingernail polishes. And I'm not against people making a living, but what's going on in those neighborhoods? They don't have the power to say that we want zoning laws so that we don't have these negative influences in our communities. So let's talk about some of the root causes of some of these things behind this globalization, neoliberalism, neoconservatism. I like this flag simply because it shows all the corporate logos. And if you look at the next chart, it talks about this corporate behavior. And what I'm saying is that, you know, again, we have to shine the light on organizational culture, that lens through institutional violence occurs through organizational culture and how it leads to programs and projects and specific actions that lead to more structural violence. So corporations, if you know anything about American history, you know that anybody ever hear the slaughterhouse cases? Okay, go back and look at American history and look at the slaughterhouse cases. When you look at these cases that took place in the late 1800s, you see that a series of cases went to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court, the SCOTUS, ruled that in favor of corporations. And this is where we get this notion that corporations now have personhood under the 14th Amendment. So corporations now have due process, equal protection, perpetual life, limited liabilities, free speech. You know, and the thing that's so terrifying about that is when the Supreme Court made that ruling, all of the cases that were supposed to be protecting freed people from slavery under the 14th Amendment were pushed aside in favor of corporations and businesses. Let's get away from that for just a moment and talk about militarism. You know, this is a map I found the other day that talks about all the different drones that's being used around the world by the United States. And this is a note from President Bush saying our military's highest priority is to defend the United States. To do so effectively, our military must assure our allies and friends, dissuade future military competition, deter threats against U.S. interests, allies, and friends, and decisively defeat any adversary if deterrence fails. Now, I don't have a problem with militarism. I grew up around Navy bases and Army bases as a kid in the South. But I think that when you look at some of the data and some of the figures, you realize that something is wrong here. For example, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, put forth this Transformative World Atlas in 2014. And this number here you see is, you know, how much money the United States spends on military. $610 billion a year. Okay? Our closest competitor is mainland China, $216 billion. You know, together, you know, those two nations spend more than the other 14 nations around the world. And in fact, we have, you know, 800 military bases around the globe. So when you think about the housing, the poverty, the hunger, our decaying infrastructure in this country, the roads, water, sanitation, purity, all kinds of things, where's that money going? It's not going to the people who need it. And remember, power to the people means democracy. If you look at the word, you break the Greek down, demos krasi, power to the people. So now the other question about militarization that Martin Luther King talked about and we're seeing more and more now is the militarization of police. We're seeing that when you look at this map, you'll see what states are doing in terms of how they're spending on military gear received by law enforcement agencies. And this is from 2006 through April 2014. Look at New Mexico and look at the bar chart about how much money we're spending on militarization of our police. This over chart right here just looks at military equipment for local police. Again, in terms of mine-resistant armor, protected vehicles, night vision pieces, aircraft, machine guns, magazines, armored vehicles. And this notion of securitization, you know, this is an interesting article that I found from 2010 that talks about laboratories of war and how the United States-Israeli collaboration, urban war, and securitization. In fact, Mayor Berry just went to Israel not too long ago to talk to Israel's security officials about how to bring in more security and military stuff for our police here in New Mexico. So urban and rural poverty, you know, the caption on the right reads, I became sick because of my poverty. Well, I became poor because of my sickness. As we talk about rural poverty, this portion represents an urban area in a city, you know, where, you know, you see the deterioration, you see the fences, the scales, the liquor stores, the garbage, you know, and, you know, in this little letter written by a resident in the city, Dear Mr. President, I heard on TV that you're giving free health care and free food to every kid in Iraq. Well, there's a war zone right here at home. I want you to liberate, because yesterday I found at my school some chemical weapons of mass destruction. Sincerely, Letitia B. And the two figures at the bottom says, chemical WMD, is it crack or heroin? So, as we talk about poverty, I want you to remember, you know, something Nelson Mandela said, poverty is not an accident. Like slavery and apartheid, it is man-made and can be removed by the actions of human beings. And the chart at the bottom basically kind of shows you the percentage of populations living on less than $1.25 per day. And some studies now clearly show that some people are living on less than 50 cents a day around the world. So, and yet even in this country, we can't even get people to give students and other workers a $15, you know, minimum wage. Skip that for a moment. So let's talk about structural violence for a moment. You know, these are social structures, economic, political, legal, religious, and cultural issues that stop individuals and groups and societies from reaching their full potential, okay? The thing about these destructive violence is embedded in the political economic organization of our social world, and it's violent because it causes physical and psychological harm to people, not necessarily those, you know, who've been impacted by it, you know, and not those responsible for perpetuating such inequalities, but it is an exploitive, unjust social, political, and economic system. So what are the alert signs of structural violence? Disease outbreaks, poverty line indicators, basic needs index, unemployment, youth without jobs, food shortages, famine, more and more physical violence, oppression, political instability, corruption, disintegration of government institutions, migration. You guys remember your first dialogue early this year when we had a professor from the University of the Aegean, and he talked about the forced migration from Asia and Africa. You know, all these things fit into this picture. This is something I'm saving for another talk in the spring, but I just had to throw it in there because I didn't want to lose the slide. But as we talk about exploitation and we talk about conflict minerals and other types of things, this is a map showing you that all the elements that's being stolen from Africa in the name of democracy, and how that quest for these resources and these materials. And again, I feel so damn guilty when I think about what's happening in the Congo just so I can have a smartphone, you know, when I realize the death, dying, and destruction that's occurring there because of that notion. But food and nutrition insecurity, civil conflict, you see the cross-country correlations between the global hunger index and other types of things. And this is in South America, it's in the Caribbean, it's in Asia as well. And we could do the same thing here in this country or on a statewide basis as well. This is a slide that I usually use with the medical students, that when you have people who've been exposed to structural violence, I let them know that medicine alone cannot deal with the many factors that cause ill health. Again, you have an impoverished person who's been afflicted by structural violence and he's complaining of a physical illness. So he goes to see a medical professional, and the doctor simply says, well, only thing I can prescribe for you is a syrup for your cough, because I don't know how to deal with poverty, hunger, injustice, caste systems, lack of facilities, myths, and exploitation. So we wind up treating people and putting them back into socially toxic environments, which means we're going to see more and more people coming into the system. Now, the thing about this structural violence in human beings, we know this from biological and sociological studies as well, and psychological studies, that it becomes embodied. People carry their histories in their bodies, okay? So bodies tell stories about and cannot be studied divorced from the conditions of our existence. They tell stories that often but not always match people's stated accounts. And bodies tell stories that people cannot or will not tell either because they are unable, forbidden, or choose not to tell. You know, stories matter. Listening to people and listening to narratives matter. And that's more important than crunching numbers sometimes. And I'm a former number cruncher as an epidemiologist, but I don't have that data input obsession anymore. I'm looking at things differently. And I'm thinking that let's get people's stories, and then we can maybe crunch some data, some numbers, and get a more specific picture. But that specific snapshot with statistics is not going to tell us what we need at that particular time. And as Benjamin Disraeli said, there's lies, there's damn lies, and then there's statistics. So pathways of embodiment is structured by social arrangements of power, property, patterns of production, consumption, reproduction. It puts constraints on our biology. Again, when we talk about the built environment of structural violence, where you live, work, play, and go to school has an impact on your health and well-being. It's cumulative in terms of the exposure, susceptibility, resistance at multiple levels, multiple domains, multiple scales of time and place. There's accountability and agency and pathways of knowledge, you know, relation to institutions, you know, as we link it back to this. So social toxicity gets under the skin. You have a socially toxic environment, and you look at the physical, the social, the cultural issues, and depending on an individual or community, what assets they have, you know, depending on how much power and things they have, it has an impact on the nervous system. And again, if there aren't other intervening variables that are there, then it can turn into a psychiatric illness or a physical illness, okay? this is the geek in me, my science background. I love this chart that I modified. This is how chronic stresses gets under the skin. And I can say this with a certain amount of comfort, because I've worked in science on the molecular side, the cellular side, the organ system side, and the behavior psychological side, and the social environmental side. And anywhere you want to cross-reference for these, one of these things, you can tie it all back to the structural environments in place and how it matters, you know, and how these influence the behavioral psychological, the organs, how it has impact on the organ systems and the cellular system and the molecular system. And if you're interested in another day, I'll show you some other science charts and we'll go through the whole pathophysiology and some other stuff, but that's for another lecture. So for me as a public health scientist practitioner, violence is a serious public health problem, okay? So when we talk about violence, we're talking about direct violence, physical, verbal, psychological acts. We're talking about structural violence, socioeconomical, political processes, culture issues. And how does it relate to peace? When we start to talk about peace, I want you to remember that peace is not merely the absence of violence. It is about a state of mutual beneficial relationships, fair structures, and a culture of peace. It's about the capacity to handle conflicts with empathy and creativity by nonviolent means. So now I'm going to give you a little bit of spiel about public health. One of the best definitions I've seen of public health is something that many people confuse with medicine. Public health is the backbone of many systems around the world. In fact, when you look at the United States of the last 100 years, public health structures and systems have given the average American more years of life and longevity than medicine has. And that's a misnomer there. So, but I like this definition from one of my law professors in public health. Public health is what we as a society do collectively to ensure the conditions for people to be healthy. Public health is that invisible perfection. Nobody thinks about it until, you know, there's a hurricane or disaster or something that's going on that people start to cry, oh, our public health system is in shambles. And it's because we're so enamored with medicine. So this future is about the conditions that include a variety of educational, economic, social, and environmental factors that are necessary for good health. And again, health is more than pills and medicine. These are just some of the public health competencies that I had to learn as a master's student. These are about, you know, well over 100 different competencies that I had learned for my master's in order to practice public health, because it is a professional degree. So biostatistics, epidemiology, social behavioral sciences, health policy and management, environmental health sciences, and then the cross-cutting issues of communications and informatics, diversity and culture, leadership, professionalism, program planning, public health biology, and systems thinking. And I really should add ethics to that now also too, which I did after this slide. Public health ethics is different than biomedical ethics. When we talk about public health ethics, we're talking about solidarity with the globe, the community, which is our patient, okay? It's about efficacy, you know, it's about integrity, it's about dignity. And the basis of public health is social justice. So these are just, you know, those skills and competencies that I've chosen that I have to work with. On this wheel, did you see the three core functions of public health? Assessment, policy development, and assurance, with research being in the center of all that. Some people, depending on who they are, focus only on one of these areas of the slice of the pie. Me, I'm greedy. I hate to say it. I've had the opportunity to work in all of these areas, you know, and feel comfortable talking about all these different areas, these 10 essential services, about monitoring health and diagnosing and investigating, informing, educating, and empowering, mobilizing community partnerships, developing policies, research, evaluation, so forth and so on. That's my bailiwick in that sense. Okay? So public health is a social institution, it's a discipline. Again, it's organized by society to protect, promote, and restore the people's health. It's a combination of sciences, it's about programs and services, institutions, and activities. And what we're trying to do really in many ways is something I learned from my work in clinical outcomes research was reducing the 6 Ds of clinical outcomes: disease, death, disability, dissatisfaction, dollars, and discomfort. So the evolution of a discipline. Infectious diseases was the first revolution of public health. The second revolution was chronic diseases, disease of lifestyle, behavior. And the third revolution is where we are right now: social issues and determinants of health, the social determinants of health. I've worked in infectious diseases and I've worked in chronic diseases before, and since I've been in New Mexico, I've moved towards that third revolution with my work. But I want to say this about some past work that I've done with emerging infectious diseases. The fact that they're borderless, their impact highlights the global vulnerabilities and the factors: human demographics and behavior, technology and industry, economic development and land use, international travel and commerce, microbial adaptation and change, and the breakdown of public health measures. How many of you have seen the film Contagion? That's the film I use with the medical students. You know, for those who haven't seen it, I'm not going to give a spoiler alert, but the very last scene in the film explains this as to why the disease outbreak took place. Spoiler alert still, just. But case in point, Ebola, or hemorrhagic fever. you know, the two boxes below list the case definition for the virus disease itself and how we look at it in U.S. healthcare settings. And this is primarily what we were involved in, you know, during this latest clamor and media furor over the last couple of months or so. But I want to say something else about this, and this is what I've been teaching the medical students also too, when I taught this to them, is that when we talk about the ecology, the Ebola virus,
okay,
bats are strongly implicated as reservoirs for the host for the virus, you know. And of the five identified virus types, there are four capable of human-to-human transmission. Now, the thing about it is that, you know, what is happening here, and if you've seen the film Contagion, this scene brings that film very, very, very much home also, too. Because what you saw was, spoiler alert, was the destruction of the rural environment. And when they destroyed that rural environment by bringing in new factories and new technologies for globalization, they destroyed the natural habitat of these bats. And these bats decided to roost elsewhere. You know, they were fruit bats, and they consumed, you know, vegetables and things, and defecated and vomited over a pig farm. The pigs ate the vomit from these bats, okay? The pig was sold to a marketer. The marketer sold the pig to a restaurant. And the farmer, when he was cleaning, and the restauranteur, the chef, when he was cleaning the pig, he had his hand all inside the pig's mouth with the blood and gore and spew, because it is mostly mucoid. He had all the virus and the mucus on his hands with the blood, and then shook hands with a woman without washing his hands. And that's how it spread. And it's the same thing that's happening here with this particular virus here, spreading in that way. So these are the outbreaks from 2014. And if you look at these dots, you'll see that, you know, Uganda 2000, 2001 up to 2014, the Democratic Republic of the Congo. I have the Philippines here because in Washington, D.C., we have a viral lab. And there's a great book called The Hot Zone. And part of the virus got free there due to some mishaps and, you know, lapses. And it spread to pigs and other types of things, and that formed in the Philippines. But the point I want to make here is that when you look at Uganda, Gabon, the Republic of Congo, South Sudan, Republic of Congo, Uganda, all these places were involved with war and conflict. And when you have war and conflict, you have mass migrations of people moving. You have less food to eat, you have less free water, clean water, you have less sanitation, you have all these different things that are having impact on the economies, and people resulted to eating meat that was not the most appropriate thing to do in many ways, but their survival was at stake, and that's how the virus really became spread. But it's rooted in conflict as well also too. So I'm gonna glance over this very quickly just to say that in terms of disease prevention, protection, and control, I'm really into primary prevention, where I'm looking at, you know, who might be susceptible to violence, how we reduce violence or the disease or the new cases of that. I'm still interested in secondary prevention, you know, looking at asymptomatic populations, you know, reducing prevalence and consequences, or tertiary prevention, you know, those where it's pretty symptomatic, where we reduce the complications and disability. And that's okay at some point, but when we look at healthcare systems in the United States right now, this is where we spend all of our $2 trillion right here in terms of tertiary care. It's like when we know that when we look at chronic disease and other things, they're 100% preventable, but we rather wait until it's fully manifested and then go down here and start treating rather than preventing. So let me back to the structural violence for just a moment. And I love this diagram in terms of structural racism, structural violence, and other types of things. Our environments cultivate our communities, and our communities nurture our health. So you have these two trees here. And I know it's difficult to read from the back, but you see one tree is thriving, the other one is not, okay? This tree, when you look at the soil and the roots that's feeding this, you know, the issues that are feeding the roots of the soil are adverse living conditions, segregation, poverty, marketing of tobacco and alcohol, unemployment, environmental toxins, discrimination, institutionalized racism, occupational hazards, poor quality schools. And it feeds this trunk of this tree, which leads to disconnected members of society, disinvestment in communities and people, restrictions on power, fragmented systems, and the chronic stresses from having to deal with all that is what causes these diseases. It's not because people's biology is defective. Okay? So when equities are high and community assets are low, health outcomes are their worst. Now when we look at this particular tree, you'll see that this is a tree that's thriving, and it has quality schools, access to healthy foods, access to healthcare, transportation resources, jobs, quality housing, clean environments, health insurance, adequate incomes, access to recreational facilities. And with that, you have organizational networks and communities. You have political influence, you have leadership, you have participation, you have social system, social support, social networks, a sense of community. And you have less of these chronic diseases because you've taken care of the things that breed it in the first place. So when equities are low and community assets are high, health outcomes are at their worst. Folks still with me? Like Samuel Jackson said in Jurassic Park, hang on to your butts, there's more. So this third revolution in public health. Again, studies have shown that the socioeconomic physical environment represents about 60% of the reasons why people get sick, okay? Healthcare system access to healthcare, quality and access is only about 25%. 15% is related to biology and genetic determinants. And so, you know, we have to start looking at our social environments and what that really means. So, as Sherlock Holmes said, when we have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. So there's something to this notion of social determinants of health and structural violence and its correlates. Again, just from the perspective of social epidemiologists, just looking at this chart a little bit differently. Downstream, upstream approaches. When I was in clinical care, this is the box that I was mostly concerned with, you know, these acute situations here. Then I got to the point of like, why am I seeing the same stuff in the emergency room and the clinics day in and day out? What's wrong with this picture? And that's what led me to go into public health, where I started about health promotion prevention and thinking about community, okay, and public advocacy. Now with this third revolution of public health, as we talk about society and institutions, I'm looking at these issues of how the intersectoral issues of working, jobs, housing, education, and studies have shown that, you know, there's an increase in health when you do that, when you focus on those issues. Let's skip levels of analysis for a while. So the public health spectrum and conflict transformation. I believe that, you know, through this public health approach, we can strengthen individual knowledge and skills. We can talk about promoting community education. We can educate providers and others. We can foster coalitions and networks. We can change organizational practices, and we can influence policy and legislation. This chart just kind of shows you the differences between public health, international, and global health. With the global issues, we're talking about levels of cooperation at the global level. We're talking about prevention and clinical care, health equity among all nations, and it's multidisciplinary. So MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, as we talk about, you know, goals and targets. WHO and other like-minded organizations, UNESCO and others, have gotten together and they had these MDGs, which we didn't achieve many of them by 2015. But as you can see, the number one goal here is ending poverty. The second goal is empowering girls and women and active and achieve gender equity. It's about promoting, providing quality education, lifelong learning, ensuring healthy lives, ensuring food security and good nutrition, achieving universal access to water and sanitation, secure sustainable energies, creating jobs, sustainable livelihoods and equitable growth, managing natural resources, assets, and sustainability, ensuring good governance and effective institutions, ensuring stable and peaceful societies, and creating a global enabling environment as a catalyst for long-term finance. These particular goals are rooted in the Declaration of Human Rights and other issues. Basically, Article 25 and 26 that says education is a human right and health is a human right. So why are we following that in the United States? Many other nations are trying to achieve it. We aren't. So diversity and equity and social justice is for all. Human dignity matters, okay, as we go through this. So what are the linkages between health and human rights? As you can see, in the intersection of the circle, we have health and human rights. And we're talking about reducing vulnerability to ill health through human rights. Right to water, right to food and nutrition, a right to education, a right to information. Human rights violations resulting in ill health, harmful traditional practices, torture, slavery, violence against women. Promotion of violation of human rights through health development, the right to participation, freedom for discrimination, freedom of movement, right to privacy. I'm big on human rights approaches, folks. I'd be crazy if I wasn't. You know, my conscience, I don't think I could stand myself. So human dignity. Violations are pervasive when their potential, the severe and sustained negative health effects. Health is not a commodity. And since my coming back from California for this last talk, you know, my little mantra right now is life and death matters. Because that's what these issues are. As we talk about global conflict, life and death matters. You know, and it shouldn't just matter because you can afford it. So how do we prevent human rights violations? We need social justice for all people. We have to advance human development. We have to prevent human suffering. And that first chart I showed you with all the data points, that really bothers me because when you talk about this notion of global issues, many people aren't aware of just how many people are suffering, either locally, nationally, or in your own communities. The issues of human security, rights and conditions that enable individuals and populations to enjoy the full potential for human life. I have to speak about inequality. Why inequality? Equality of what? Process, outcomes, and opportunities. Inequality between whom? So, I think one of the questions when we talk about process, equality of what? I think we need to start asking the questions in education and surveys rather than what have you got? We should ask, how did you get it? when we talk about outcomes, we have to talk about, you know, how it's absent from policy rhetoric, but what will those outcomes be? And what does it mean to have a healthy society? In terms of opportunities, we have to talk about, you know, the differences between meritocracy, responsibility, egalitarianism, or capabilities approach, which Amartya Sen really talks a lot about in terms of human rights issues and poverty. It's really great stuff to look at, particularly from those who like behavioral economics. So we have equalized positive freedom to achieve value functionings. Equality between whom? Individuals, genders, ethnic groups, other groups, generations, geographic areas, nations. Human rights-based approaches. The state has an obligation to respect, to protect, and fulfill. Okay? So this is about promoting social progress and population health. It's about promoting social progress and better standards of life and larger freedom. And, you know, from that last diagram I showed you, you know, you'll see that there's a, you know, it's imbalanced. All the power, all the wealth exists below, above the equator in the northern hemisphere, which is why you have so much, you know, so many people moving from the southern hemisphere into other areas because of that structural violence. And as Albert Einstein said, knowledge is experience. Everything else is just information. Health diplomacy. I'm almost finished, folks. Health diplomacy, my latest thing here. As Malcolm X once said, you can't separate peace from freedom because no one can be at peace unless they have freedom. You know, and, okay. So the program that I'm working with right now, we're in terms of strategic peace building education, we're talking about justice and healing. We're talking about violence prevention and conflict transformation. We're talking about systems, institutional change and development. I think you got a feel for some of that just from some of the background stuff that I've supplied you with thus far. This is just the cycles of victimhood and transformation, destructive versus constructive. We need constructive reconciliation practices that are dedicated to peace and healing and justice and healing. The context of peacemaking diplomacy, that the agenda needs to change. There needs to be agreement on that and implementation. The health conflict peace nexus. Health diplomacy just basically focuses on international relations and explores the interactions between global health and foreign policy. Understanding state-sponsored structural violence and role of state power, whether it's geopolitic, realpolitik, capital politic, ideopolitik. You know, are we a failed state or are we a fragile state? You know, we know there are nations and judging by some of the things I see in New Mexico, my adopted state, I have to say that we're on the verge of being a failed state or a very fragile state as well. So I feel that health is, can be used as a bridge to peace. And so there are three claims to that. Peace as a prerequisite for health, health interventions that can change attitudes that may have political effects, and an orientation to have people and decision makers understand the pain and suffering of populations and how prevention is better than cure and what our ethical and professional duties are. So this is a conceptual framework for analyzing health as a bridge to peace and integration of the skills into government, global health governance and practice in terms of conflict analysis, negotiation, mediation, facilitation, dialogue and conflict on issues rather than debate, giving voices to marginalized communities, advocacy, establishing relations across the divides, trust building, peace building and conflict transformation education, responding to cultural, historical, psychosocial trauma, monitoring, evaluation. The preamble of the United Nations Charter, we the people of the United Nations to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, which twice in our lifetime has brought untold sorrow to mankind, and to reaffirm faith in fundamental human rights, in the dignity and worth of a human person, in the equal rights of men and women and of nations large and small, to establish conditions under which justice and respect for the obligations arising from treaties and other sources of international law can be maintained, and to promote social progress and better standards of life and larger freedom, and for these ends, to practice tolerance and live together in peace with one another as good neighbors, to unite our strength to maintain international peace and security, and to ensure by the acceptance of principles and the institution of methods that armed force shall not be used save in the common interest, and to employ international machinery for the promotion of the economic and social advancement of all peoples. Building blocks, diplomacy, treaties, conferences, rules of warfare, regulations of use, movements of world government, international trade, they all fit into this. For those who are interested in human rights-based approaches, let's work to make sure the United States honors these 9 core human rights treaties. The International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the International Covenant on Civic and Political Rights, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, the Convention Against Torture and Other Cruel, Inhuman, and Degrading Treatment or Punishment, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Convention on the Protection of the Rights of All Migrant Workers and Members of Their Families, the Convention on the Protection of All Persons from Enforced Disappearance, and Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. The United States have signed off on some of these treaties, but some of them have never been ratified by the United States Senate. In over 30 years, we have not ratified some of these treaties. What does that say about us when we go to talk to other nations about peace and democracy? we're being hypocritical. So these are just some other issues in terms of, you know, how human rights obligations are applicable to international humanitarian law. This is something that when I was with the Department of Pediatrics at the School of Medicine in Hawaii, one of my mentors got me involved in humanitarian assistance and designing classes and doing work, you know, for natural and human generated disasters around the world. And he threatened me that if I didn't go back to school and get my PhD, he was going to kick my backside. So I did it. So last but not least, you know, as Sandler says in 2007, one cannot be on the side of social justice without questioning the practices, the epistemologies, the methods and frameworks that contribute to the structure and norms of injustice and oppression. As Angela Davis said, I'm no longer accepting the things I cannot change. I'm changing the things I can no longer accept. So, I'm afraid you've had a paradigm shift. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
One of the things that, as I was listening to Jamal speak, I will reveal, I am by training an economist, and I was hearing a tension between things that are perceived as privately owned, tertiary healthcare. I pay a doctor to take care of me when I'm sick, as opposed to things that are publicly provided. I provide a healthy environment in which all people can thrive. And just sort of historically, things have gone in waves. The country has been much more aligned toward providing public goods, publicly providing education, publicly providing health, certain things. And then sometimes there's a backlash where people have to, you want it, you buy it. I think Jamal on one of his slides said, sorry, I don't have my glasses on. Health is not a, I know they're right there, they're kind of homely. Health is not a commodity. And I think there are a number of people who believe healthcare is a commodity that's bought and sold, just like food. The absence of hunger might be a commodity. You go to Albertsons or wherever you go and you buy it. Or shelter is a commodity. And so I guess I would like to ask Jamal, how do you draw the line between things that we should collectively engage in and provide and support and things that are more individualistic? I'm giving you an easy one.
Oh, is that an easy one?
That was my easy one.
Okay. I think, first of all, coming from the perspective of now wearing my hat in peace and justice studies, I'm opposed to debate. And I think because when you look at debate, it's one side trying to win over the other side. It's not a consensus. It's not a win-win situation. So I'm in favor of having dialogues about the commonalities that should be thought of as a basic human right. And unfortunately, we have not had those opportunities to have that discussion in this country for fear of being called a socialist or a communist, which I'm of neither. I believe in democratic socialism, I suppose, in a democratic republic. But I think these are questions that should be open to the population. And this is where I think education sort of fails in many ways, because we have an education system that doesn't allow for us to have these conversations in a fair and just way. And this is what I meant about part of this work is, for me, is about how do we undo 500 years of colonial education? How do we decolonize minds to this process of understanding human dignity and worth? And it's something that you really can't put a dollar figure on. It's about continuing the dialogues and it's about educating. But I do think at some point we do have to start thinking about what it means to have a different form of a political economy that's fair and just. That's not to say that people can't have private property and shouldn't own private property, but we have a system that's it's excessive in its behaviors at this point in time. So how do we curb that greed and that avarice? And that gets back to some of the values also too. So there's no easy question to this just yet, but I'm open to the opportunities to continue having the dialogues. And one of the things I'm trying to do through peace and justice studies is to help students become develop strategic peace-building skills so that when they leave the program, they can have these conversations in communities or with other individuals or in organizations and try to help someone find that aha moment.
So I think I could talk to Jamal forever, as I've already revealed, but I would like to hear what your responses to that delusion of information. what are some of the immediate strategies that we need to start working with to rebuild communities?
Some of the immediate strategies?
Yes, that we as college students can begin engaging in.
Well, I think it, you know, for most students, I think it starts with their own reflection. You know, why, what type of education, interrogating their own privilege and their own power, and figuring out, you know, what it is that they need to do. Because I've often told students that that if I find that they're committing oppression after I'm dead and gone, I'm going to come back and haunt them. but aside from all that, it is about the self-reflection and the awareness of the suffering. And when you go to do work in communities, I think one of the things that I've learned in public health is not to come in that I know everything, that I know it all. It's to listen to the people, because they have to deal with whatever it is they're dealing with on a day-to-day basis, and they know their needs better than I do from looking at literature, any studies that I might conduct. And I'll give an example of that. Usually at the federal government level, when they put forth a block grant fund, they'll put forth funding for a public health project in the community. And they will go to their community and say, we want everybody to be immunized against a particular childhood disease, which is okay in some ways. But the community will say, well, you know what? We have problems, but immunization is not our biggest problem in our communities. We're trying to deal with some of these structural issues in terms of negotiating spaces for fine, clean, healthy air, water, sanitation, food, recreational areas, and we're not listening to those folks. And so it does begin with listening and narratives. You know, the rhetoric of listening is a very important thing, attribute of that, and your own self-reflection and interrogating yourself in terms of being very conscious of not perpetuating the status quo. I mean, I met certain people who have had anti-racism training going through it 5 times, and I still see them doing the same crazy stuff. I'm just like, wow, but they're still bragging that they've gone through the training. And so they haven't had that epiphany yet. So that would be one thing. But I think one thing, you know, student activism, someone asked me about this the other day, and I don't know whether they're going to print my interview in the Lobo or not, and how they're going to edit it or whatever it is they're going to do. But I've got my hard copy so I can refute them if they do something wrong. But students have a lot more power than we bargain for. If students got together and banned to talk about these issues, people would listen. And there's historical precedence for that. I mean, not just during the 60s, but even the 40s and 50s in major league, you know, universities and stuff. So, but it begins with you folks and how you question. You know, one of the things that I do in my classes is that I'm not interested in the answers. I'm interested in the questions. And if you notice, one of the things that I've mentioned was that and some of the students who've had me before, they know that one of my favorite words is metacognition. You know, I ask them, you know, to reflect on their own thinking about thinking while thinking, to improve their thinking. And why do I do that? Because there are three functions of the brain or the mind: thinking, feeling, and wanting. Your thinking helps you make sense of the world. You know, it helps you make sense of your feelings in terms of what's positive, what's negative. And those two aspects really sort of drive your motivation and your desire to do whatever. And I think most people are trapped into feeling and desire, and they're not even thinking about things, they're just reacting. And this is hard work. This is hard work. I mean, it's not an easy task. When I was in California a couple of weeks ago, I met an activist from the 60s. And you know, one of the things that she's teaching out in the California schools there is just like, how do we build allies? You know, and I think one way to build allies is to talk about the fact that our commonalities, we're all human beings. You know, and getting past the myths of, you know, democracy, racism, health, all the other things. I mean, race is a myth, but racism is a reality. You know, and I keep trying to tell people, there's only one race, and that's the human race. So there's a whole lot of scientific racism that we have to undo also, too, that's embodied in these books and this knowledge that maintains their status quo. And this is why I get in trouble with other professors, because students, they start challenging other professors, and I tell them, you know, do your work, be scholarly.
Don't do that.
Well, no, I want them to be better at this than I am, and I'm no good at it, you know. I want them to be better. But the idea is that do it through your scholarship, you know, be effective with that. You know, do the citations, do the research, perform your arguments, use the logic, use all these skills effectively and efficiently, you know, and don't get caught up in the hubris. There's a lot more, you know, forgive me, there's a lot more, so. I think it's huge, both counts. I mean, when you think about the arsenic in our water, the other issues, the pesticides. Oh, yeah, the jet spill in Kirtland, you know, all types of things. And all these results of As Eisenhower once said when he left office in the 50s, beware the military-industrial complex. But in addition to the military-industrial complex, we also have the medical-pharmaceutical-industrial complex. We have the agriculture-business complex. We have the security-military-industrial complex. I mean, so this thing is snowballing like crazy. But all these things, I mean, you know, I think as we look at my adopted state, New Mexico, right now, as I try to understand this, I think about what Governor Lew Wallace once said when he was territorial governor. Everything you tried elsewhere would absolutely not work in New Mexico. And as I think about that, and as I think about that statement, I realize that at some point we are victims of a colonized system. You know, so again, so how do we undo colonized minds? I mean, I lived in Hawaii for 20 years before coming here, so I've lived in two different colonized states and places and things, and I've seen many of the same similarities and things. So it comes down to, you know, education again, and what we mean by education. Carter G. Woodson, an African American scholar in the 1930s, wrote The Miseducation of the Negro. And I always add, and everybody else, you know, because we have an educational system that fosters a mindset that just says, grab what you can get, and it's all about the individual. It's not about families, communities, and it's not about the connections. So there's a great deal of spirituality that's missing from that as well. And sometimes I feel like I need to learn how to perform exorcisms. No, really, I'm starting to think that I'm gonna go back and start relearning Latin and start figuring some stuff out. You know, I think it's bad. I mean, when you think about it, we have the fifth largest state in terms of land area. And Brooklyn, New York has more people than we have in this entire state. So when you think about the poverty, the educational issues, why are we always tied with Mississippi and Louisiana? You know, in fact, they just recently passed us not too long ago by a few percentage points, but that gives them bragging rights. So with all this education that we have in this state, well, how come we can't do better? But right now, we've had a lot of disinvestment in education. We have people in the state at the legislative area, I'm going to say it, and it's on tape, at the Regents area level and higher administration, who don't believe that education is about a human value and human worth, that education is about increasing your own material wealth and gain. And it's not about the development of the whole person. It's not a very holistic approach. And so when you have that mindset making decisions, it can lead to some nasty, you know, forms of structural violence. So it has to be dismantled or eradicated. But again, as a scholar activist, you know, now my hat, I'm saying that, and we used to have these arguments back in the 60s, these debates and discussions. We're dealing with a system that can't be reformed. So I would tell you students that become entrepreneurs in the sense that you develop your own institutions and organizational bodies to compete against it. Because that may be the only way it's going to change, is to compete against it. Because when you look at the major Ivy League schools in this country, what were they founded on? Slave money and the slave trade and insurance industry that identified, you know, the ships and things. And, you know, and the individuals who had the power to send their male sons to those schools, you know, maintain that power and privilege. So it's been perpetuating. There's a lot more to it than this. We can't be covered in just 15 minutes or so. It requires, you know, other lengthy dialogues. And this notion that we're having here now in terms of peace, conflict, and transformation, you know, social transformation, is a good way to start. So my hat's off to my colleague Elaine and others who put this class together. You know, and I appreciate the time and energy to be invited to kind of put in my two cents.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I want to go back to something you said about power.
Mm-hmm.
I asked my students this semester to define power,
mm-hmm.
and they all came back with the political science definition that it's the ability to force someone to do something that you want them to do.
Mm-hmm. Right. No.
And I suggested, which I think you did in one of your earlier slides,
mm-hmm.
that power was really about the ability to have choices,
mm-hmm.
and to have some influence over the conditions in which you live.
Mm-hmm.
And they totally didn't buy it.
I'm sorry?
They totally didn't buy
it
at all.
Mm.
So how do you define power, and how do you change the discussion about power?
That's a good question. And the Daily Lobo asked me this question the other day, so I don't know if they printed my full remarks, but I'm going to read my answers to them. They said, how much power lies in the hands of students compared to the president of UNM? And my reply was, of course, both groups possess extraordinary power. However, I think that the most promising way to answer this question is by conducting a power analysis. Please note that I'm not referring to a statistically significant difference when the null hypothesis is false, but a critical reflection and analysis of the types, sources of power, and skill sets exhibited by leadership in organizations. For example, are we talking about power over, power with others, or power from within? Let me repeat that. Power over, power with others, or power from within. Said differently, getting someone to do something against their will, influencing and taking action on uniting with others, or influencing and taking actions based on intention, clarity of vision, or charisma. You know, a more important maxim related to power is that both groups need to endorse the aphorism that with great power comes great responsibility. I'm an old Spider-Man fan from about 1960. Related to that statement is this thought from Albert Einstein: those who have the privilege to know have the duty to act. So when they answer that question, just coming strictly from a political science perspective, it means that it's sort of a myopic view of perspective, which is why I like to talk about integrative thought and integrative thinking and functions, and how do we have, you know, this whole notion of discipline B here and discipline A here and poli-sci here and say psychology here, political psychology. And you come together and they form a new stream of consciousness where you look at the gaps that exist within those two disciplines and understand the different relationships with solving problems. Whereas before, if you just looked at it through this way, it's very myopic. Same way when you look at multidisciplinary studies, you know, you have, you know, B here, A here. The problem with this is that they just mirror one another. There's no interaction. There's no integration of the thoughts and methods and theories and concepts. So transdisciplinary studies is something, it helps build that integrative thinking and those functions for solving complex problems.
Coming from Greece, of course, I can say that ancient Athens was colonizing, had its share of colonizing, and also its share of inequality. And so we might have to go back and before Eden or something to see, to undo the injustices and inequities. That was one point. The idea of liberal education, in Roman times, they used the term liberal, meaning people who didn't need to make a living. Mm-hmm. So they were doing it. And it's not a bad idea,
no,
but
it
also meant that it was for an elite group that, that had that. But I wanted to share an insight that I had following your talk today, but also listening to the conversations, thinking about the conversations we've had in the past and also some of the other speakers here, because I'm beginning to see connections. And I'm not actually worried about making the disciplines cross and fertilize each other and so on, but rather looking at problems that are parallel in different fields and that maybe a shift in thinking will help us to address them. And specifically, you talk about disease, that we wait until it becomes critical, and then we do something, as opposed to doing preventive care. Similarly, our justice system does the same thing. We'll say, oh, I will sue the bastards, instead of having some way to come into preventive inequality, let's say, you know, to discuss this before it reaches the critical point, and then you either have the $1 million lawsuits, or you have a whole disenfranchised group of people like the Walmart workers or something like that. And thirdly, more specifically to this class, addressing conflict. Again, many of the talks were about preventing the conflict, not starting to discuss it. So I see this pattern of using the concept of preventive medicine, of which your field has promoted the most, I think, to also saying preventive justice or whatever we want to call it, and preventive conflict. So I can see the different disciplines getting together to say, well, we have this model that works, and maybe we can transfer it, or maybe we can tell you what are the steps that help convince people that it's worth investing in the preventive part, the first part. So I'm actually brainstorming.
No, thinking about protocols are excellent.
Yeah.
They help solve problems, thinking about protocols, and while you're reflecting on this, you know, I thought of a couple of things. The fact that, you know, when you say going back, this is what I mean sometimes when I think about the spiritual nature of this problem and that void. I mean, case in point, I remember watching a movie not too long ago called Noah. And I thought to myself, how in the hell is Russell Crowe going to play Noah? You know? But I was pleasantly surprised because, you know, I had a guilty pleasure moment at a particular time. But the thing about it that was interesting to me, but it you know, basically it outlined this whole story of humankind in its sense, when the human family split after the first fratricide, and you have two, and you have, so you have two sets of family, one basically, one side of the family believing in sustainability and protecting the earth, and another side of family basically believing in excessive greed, corruption, destroying the land, destroying the animals, doing all kinds of crazy things. And that spoke to me, because I thought to myself, like, wow, maybe we're dealing with the mark of Cain right now on that level, in that sense. But be that as it may, I do think that it's hard for people to understand prevention. And in fact, I think that some people suffer. I think we suffer from prevention deficit disorder in many ways. And so... Well, I think there's something to it. So, but I do think that I'm really big on this notion of finding, I'm in the minority of opinion with this when I talk about this from the perspective of public health. There's some people who see public health as a problem, see violence as a public health problem, but they only see it from the perspective of fratricide, maternal side, homicide, suicide, things of that nature, or domestic violence. I'm like, no, it's greater than that, because we are talking about structures and things. And so I'm grateful for the opportunity to kind of have another forum, you know, to kind of talk about these issues in that way, to inspire students to kind of think differently, think outside of the box, and keep pushing the edges of those envelopes to have those discussions, you know, and to brain solve, problem solve in unique ways. Should I say something about Democrats? Okay.
So as Jamal was speaking, and I wrote in a little note, I see that sort of reflected in the polarization that we have politically, that certainly some politicians truly advance that very autonomous, individualistic, you know, I'm in it for myself, that kind of belief that that's inherent human nature, and then another people, probably Bernie Sanders would be the poster child, mm-hmm. poster grown-up, mm-hmm. for a more collectivist view of how we should provide resources. And I think that ideological split, as it becomes increasingly hard to bridge that in our political structure, really argues or it fights against our ability to communicate across it. Mm-hmm. I think it was easier to talk to say, well, you know, I'm thinking that people should be more collectivist, and instead of saying, well, you know, that's kind of socialist. Maybe people should be responsible individuals. I don't think we can have that conversation anymore. I think, you know, it's just, this is my belief, and the rest of you are wrong. And I think that breaking down that polarization, you know, going back to the days when there were only three networks, where you watch your news instead of one network for every belief system, went out.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
So you're saying that education is kind of one of the like, key components or one of the most important aspects of trying to change things. And I've heard that like all my life. But in terms of people who don't have access to that education that can help change, what steps would you feel would be necessary to kind of establish that like fundamental like understanding of what needs to be done in their communities, or kind of like you said, locally while thinking globally? Because most people don't either have that access, have that kind of like that outward perspective of what to see outside of their own neighborhood. So it kind of gets them stuck in that like cycle of staying here. So how do you feel as if, like what steps should they take for education in order to help them think on a larger scale?
Well, one thing I think is for sure is that, you know, we need to start promoting literacy. I think that's the thing that saved my life as a very young person, you know, learning to read and finding reading. I mean, I used to read the encyclopedia for fun. You know, I'm not saying I was a geek all the time, but I did some mischievous things, but I used to like to read because it opened my world around me. And I think that's one thing we can do, particularly with young kids. And when you think about that also too, as we think about these conflicts in terms of politics and things, when we look at this notion of adult literacy in this country, 90 million adult Americans are functionally or marginally illiterate. So when you have that many adult Americans who are functionally marginally literate and they are voters, what does that tell you? You know, what does that lead to? You know, there's a tie in there. You know, one of the epiphanies that I had was, you know, one day in clinic, I used to run a specialty clinic on Kawasaki disease when I was doing some of my research in pediatrics, and just observing all the other things coming in the clinic with me one day, as I said earlier, I thought, like, why am I seeing the same cases day in and day out? You know, and as I started to analyze the data and listen to people and stories and things, I began to see how education or different forms of education had an impact on lives of people. And studies again clearly show that it is the most robust predictor of health and well-being. But we've been normed into believing that education is about the creation of personal wealth. And so again, how do we decolonize that? And it's by challenging, it's by speaking truth to power in many ways. There's so much more to this. I'm sorry that I probably seems like I'm dancing around your question. But these are issues that I'm still dealing with also too in terms of, you know, what I'm doing. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I got out of health sciences for a moment and came to UNM to get my doctorate in education so that I could try to do a better job at this, you know, and try to figure out something better. You know, so how do we, you know, go off and, you know, leave the ivory towers and go into the communities and have conversations with people without being condescending, you know, and walking with kings and still keeping that common touch, you know, and doing that type of work, you know. And even how we transform this in schools. I mean, what is a health literate child? You know, National Council of Education says that a health literate child is an effective communicator, is a problem solver and a critical thinker, and an engaged citizen. And those are aspects of health literacy.
So I'm currently writing a research paper on early multicultural education for children between the ages 5 and 12. Mm-hmm. And there's two questions to this. One, I presented the proposal to my teacher, and he understood it as, okay, so this child of this culture will go to this class and learn about that, or this one, like a separation. And I was telling him, no, that's not the idea. The idea is everyone learns it together, mm-hmm. to get an understanding. So how would I explain that understanding to a professor? And then how would you go about presenting the importances of understanding multiple cultures to a child between the ages of 5 and 12? Because you can explain the importance to a student or to an adult because they'll understand.
Sometimes.
Sometimes. Sometimes. Miso students, I don't know. But,
well,
how would you go about explaining it to a child?
As Frederick Douglass once said, it's easier to fix broken children than it is broken adults. Look at some of the work of people who are doing marvelous work in terms of social justice and education. Even look at some of the early works of John Dewey. Look at the works of Maria Montessori. Look at the work of Paulo Freire. You know, and then from the African American side, look at people like Du Bois and others. I mean, there's so many different things that you can look at in terms of this notion of using education as an emancipatory way of learning. There's a website that I can give you later that has lots of interesting tests and quizzes on it for doing multicultural stuff, and I've used some of them in classrooms. So just email me later, I'll give you my email, and then I can share that website with you and some of those tools for interrogating that. One way of looking at this too is that, I don't know if you know Professor Roberto Ibarra in sociology. He was the first head of our diversity program here many years ago before they started moving away from it, not giving them a budget to do anything. But he wrote a book called Beyond Affirmative Action. And when I first saw the book, I thought, like, what is he getting at here? But when I read it, I thought, like, oh, this is a marvelous piece of sociological and cultural anthropology work in terms of how we look at the two cultures, one being high, one being low, and what those preferences are in terms of their ideologies, in terms of how people learn about time, space, privilege, and things of that nature. Take a look at that also, too. You know, that'll really open up your eyes and some things like, oh, now I get this in terms of, you know, how people are normed into Western modes of thinking as opposed to indigenous cultures and indigenous knowledge, which we're tending to disrespect more and more, because a lot of the indigenous knowledge that we've had for centuries and ages is being discredited and then pimped off of.
So the president recently gave a speech in Turkey at the G20. Towards the end of his speech, he talked about how a lot of people in power in the U.S. would keep on suggesting, like, oh, why don't we go to these different countries and bomb them or attack them and all these different things. And after he finished explaining that about five different times, he was saying how it bothered him and it angered him how, and also you can see he was very irritated, how a lot of people get a general idea
of another country or another religion and whatnot, and just stick with that idea. Don't bother looking for further information or anything or understanding it. Just it's just indirected hate, and that's about it. How would you go about inspiring, or I guess convincing people to actually look into these problems and understand why they're there?
Well, you know, this is hard because a lot of times, you know, and you feel like you're throwing pearls before swine in many ways. The idea is to maintain your, you know, your own issues of integrity when you go through this. I've often said to students that our issues are not really so much about color. Our enemies are really fear, doubt, ignorance, and superstition. And the only way to overcome fear, doubt, ignorance, and superstition is to establish truth, justice, mercy, and compassion. So when you start working from those particular virtues, you know, and you need them, protect yourself with this, because folks, you're gonna, you know, as you folks become scholar, activists, and workers in this area, you're gonna walk out the door on a daily basis and be offended by a lot of stuff. You're gonna be under spiritual attack and physical attack in many ways. So the idea is to maintain your own focus and have those conversations and those talks. But from a secular side, if I move from that spiritual side for just a moment, we had a professor here at the university who passed on some time ago. His name was Everett Rogers. And he was a world-class expert in this theory called the theory of diffusions and innovations. And I got hip to it when I was living in Hawaii, when I was doing clinical outcomes research. And when I got here, I thought, like, wow, this guy's here. I need to talk with him. But he was on sabbatical, and I never got a chance to meet him. And he died shortly thereafter. But his theory basically says that... I'll explain. You know, if you take a bell-shaped curve, okay? And on one side of the curve, you have, you know, he says, anytime you introduce any new concept or innovation to a population or to a group or technological innovation, only 3% of the population is going to get it. They're the innovators. Okay, so obviously you continue working with the innovators. But as you work with the innovators, those innovators, you know, the people who are watching innovators are the early adapters and the late adapters. That's the other side of that 34% of that curve, you know, 16% there. They're watching to see what the other group does before they adapt to whatever the innovators are doing. The laggards are on the far end of that tail or the other side of that bell-shaped curve. They're never going to get it. So why even bother talking with them? Just keep working with the people who get it and strengthening each other and fortifying each other in patience and faith and constancy. This is hard work, folks. I mean, this is not easy. It takes courage. It takes faith. It takes a lot of strength. When you move into education, these other types of things. I didn't get into this for the money. You know... I didn't get into this for the money. I really didn't, you know. In fact, my little joke now is I feel like I'm one of the Blues Brothers. I'm on a mission from God, you know. Yeah. But that's just one aspect of it. And it's to keep having those conversations with other like-minded folks. You know, yeah, you're preaching to the choir, but you strengthen each other. You strengthen each other's resolve because everybody's going through something different or slightly, you know, askew, and they need support as well. And you all need support with this. And so a class like this in terms of conflict resolution and transformation, I'm going to have to put in a plug for my program now. You got to take some classes with us. That's right. We have.
So maybe this is a good time to thank you, Conflic, for your.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you, folks.